Please pray with me. God of grace, speak to us a new word. Remind us that our lives matter to you and to our world. To that end, may the words of my mouth be even more important. May the meditations of our hearts please you, O Lord, for you alone are our rock and our redeemer. Celebration of All Saints Sunday and Reformation Sunday is a perennial conundrum, as they both fall on the same Sunday. And generally on the last Sunday in October here at Westwood Presbyterian Church, we focus our attention on the All Saints side of this double holy day in order to honor those saints we have loved and lost over the previous year. Reformation Sunday has traditionally gotten short shrift. But 2017 marks the 500th anniversary of the beginning of the Protestant Reformation, and it seems fitting that we would give it its own Sunday for our reflection and celebration. Reformation Sunday used to be a morning on which Protestants would routinely trash the Pope and celebrate the fact that they were not Catholics. In my household of origin, Catholics were not considered Christians, as if we were the ones who got to decide. My grandparents would not vote for John Kennedy because of his Catholic faith and the very real possibility that he just might be the evil Antichrist. And marriage between a Catholic and Protestant was considered an epic tragedy. But gratefully, the rift has softened over the years, and we have discovered and embraced what we have in common, rather than dwell on what divides. Still, in the 16th century, the church was a mess. Gary and I have just finished watching The Borgias, a Netflix series loosely based on the exploits of the late 15th century Pope Alexander VI, Rodrigo Borgia and his duplicitous children, Giovanni, Cesare, and Lucrezia. The series is not for the faint of heart, and I do not recommend it. But it does give insight into a church that had lost its spiritual bearings, its very reasons for existing. Political intrigue and infighting, wars between city-states in quest of papal power, the amassing of great wealth at the expense of the poor, orgies in the Vatican Palace, the selling of heaven, it was awful. No need to watch it. The list goes on and on. It seems the church had become the purveyor of evil rather than the champion of good. It is a horrifying series to watch. The takeaway being that God must really love the church, as we have worked so hard over the centuries to kill it off. The church had lost its way, and on the eve of All Saints Day 1517, 33-year-old Catholic scholar, priest, and monk Martin Luther posted 95 theses, a list of questions and complaints for debate, on the door of the Castle Church in Wittenberg, Germany. His list of concerns was introduced with these words: out of love for the truth and the desire to elucidate it, the Reverend Father Martin Luther, Master of Arts in Sacred Theology and ordinary lecturer therein at Wittenberg, intends to defend the following statements and to dispute on them in that place. Therefore, he asks that those who cannot be present and dispute with him orally shall do so in their absence by letter. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Luther had not intended to launch a revolution. He was hoping for a renewed church and was simply inviting others to the academic discussion that he had titled A Disputation on the Power and Efficacy of Indulgences. Still, his 95 statements announce a radical departure from the teachings of the church. and they are set within the context of an already roiling intellectual, political, and cultural context all across Europe. Luther contended that the Bible, not Rome, is the source of religious authority, and that salvation is ours through faith, not through works. And his most focused critique took on the practice of selling indulgences, paying for God's forgiveness, expensive tickets out of purgatory that lined the church coffers, and mainly at the expense of the poor. The spiritual and religious context in which Luther grew up was a terrifying one. Life was short, and it was difficult and often painful, and hovering on top of all of that was an angry, judgmental God. And if that was not enough stress, looming at the end of an already difficult life was, at worst, eternal torment, and at best, a very long sentence to a purgatory of agony before finally being invited into heaven. And so it was understandable that the sale of indulgences took on such power. So great was the dread of the anguish of purgatory. The only hope was to do whatever you could to appease an almost angry, always angry God. And so for Martin Luther and many others, life was a daunting struggle to be good enough, in hopes that God would reduce your time in purgatory, take you into heaven sooner rather than later. And Luther was tormented by this. He was desperate to please God, and so he did everything imaginable. He prayed and he fasted. He made a pilgrimage to Rome. He climbed a very long staircase on his knees, all in hopes of finding peace with God. But peace did not come. It was in his monk's cell, sitting at his desk, preparing lectures on Paul's letter to the church in Rome, that Luther's great aha came. Scott read it earlier. The words that forever changed Luther's and potentially our lives. Luther read this: "Therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to the grace in which we stand." Luther described this moment as feeling altogether born again, and that the very gates of paradise opened up before him. Now, Luther's epiphany had been right there all along, hidden under centuries of accumulated church dogma. But Luther finally realized that it was the church that was mistaken. God does not have to be persuaded to be gracious toward us. God is predisposed to grace. Attending Mass, going to confession, self-flagellation, walking up flights of stairs on your knees, none of it causes grace. God is gracious, period. And God's grace precedes any human action. God is eternally gracious, and grace cannot be bought, because love cannot be bought. And God is love. Imagine the seismic jolt of such a radical notion, not only for Martin Luther, but for medieval society. As Presbyterians, we have, I hope, heard a lot about grace as we sit here week in and week out. Grace is our normal, and we can almost take it for granted. But imagine having never grown up with it, knowing nothing about it, and one day you wake up to this stunning new reality. The God you believed for your lifetime to be a stern, and nearly impossible to please God. You'd lived frightened and despairing of ever being or doing enough to escape the fires of hell. Imagine the liberation of waking up one morning and realizing you've been duped. Why, God is nothing of this sort. Rather, God is merciful and kind, even loving. And for Luther, this changed everything. He no longer had to wonder if he was good enough or doing the wrong thing. And the life beyond no longer was terrifying. And that is exquisitely good news. And the peace with God that Luther had so desperately longed for became real. Again, in his words, he felt altogether born again. The very gates of paradise opened up before him, and he walked right through. And the rest is history. Luther sets off a firestorm that ultimately gets him excommunicated. His writings are deemed scandalous and offensive to pious ears. He went into hiding and spent his time translating the Bible so that people could read and understand it for themselves. And all the while, this radical new thought spreads across Northern Europe. John Calvin, a young French lawyer, was taken with Luther's radical notions of grace. Calvin settled in Geneva and there created a new way of being church based on the value and worth of every individual rather than simply those who occupied positions of power. Representative democracy, it was called. John Calvin became the driving force of the Reformation and the father of Presbyterianism we had inherited. And all because grace broke through. Along with Luther and many others, I counted the turning point of my own life. The moment I finally got grace. As a daughter of a fundamentalist pastor, I was raised with the word grace, but with a very clear sense that it was conditional. That God would love me if. That I would be acceptable only if. And so I carried a deep sense of inadequacy and of fear, certain that I would never be good enough. But one night, grace came to me. I was in a boxing ring. My fundamentalist father, my opponent, and I was getting creamed, bloodied. The agony of the fight was made even worse because I looked across the ring. My father's trainer, his corner man, was Jesus himself. Round after round we went, my father landing jab after jab. I was pummeled, and I knew in that moment that I would die. But then came a life-altering moment. The round ended. My father moved to his corner and I staggered and sat in mine. And then I watched as Jesus stood and he made his way around the ring to my corner. He handed me a towel. He rubbed my shoulders. He whispered in my ear, "We've got this." Now you psychoanalysts out there have at it. But this was my Martin Luther moment. I was altogether born again, and the very gates of paradise opened before me. Grace became real. I finally got it. The Christian faith is not about being good enough. It is not about guilt and fear. here. Rather, it is the celebration of divine grace. The truth that God already loves us is in our corner without our doing a thing. It has been 500 years since Luther reminded us of the simple life and world-altering truth of God's amazing grace. The reality that someone is always in our corner, the Divine One, who smiles on us, who delights in us, who opens before us the gates of paradise, and who invites us to live not in fear and guilt, but rather in confidence and in joy. As 18th century repentant slave owner John Newton would one day put it, through many dangers, toils, and snares, we have already come. 'Tis grace has brought us safe this far. And grace will lead us home. Let us pray. Lord, may your grace bring about a reformation in our lives, day in and day out. May it free us to love one another, to enjoy being the apple of your eye, to be open to signs and to hints of your grace all around us, and to be purveyors of grace in our hurting world. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Amen and amen. Grateful for so great a love as this, let us give generously as the ushers come, that this church might continue to be a purveyor of grace in our harmed and